Mass market is a term that, as marketers, we throw around constantly. But I think just to help us define, Terry, you know, what consumers actually fall into the mass market segments, particularly in South Africa?
I think in South Africa and in many markets, in many emerging markets, the mass market is really refers to the market in which products have a vast appeal. So the great example of a mass market product would be a Coca-Cola. Mm-hmm. And typically in a country of South Africa's size, about 46 million people, your mass market would be about half of that. Let's say about 24, 25 million. If you look into Africa with a population now about 500 million people, growing up to being a billion in the next 20 to 30 years, you're looking at an existing mass market of about 250 to 300 million people, growing to be about 500 million people very quickly.
So a huge opportunity for brand owners and marketers here in the emerging markets.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, really, brands across the world look to Africa as very much being sort of the last untapped market.
Yeah.
And are scrambling to get a foothold in the market, but also to try and understand the market a lot better.
Mm. Now, Ian, over to you. If we think of mass market, we think of sort of a blanket approach, and we think of big budgets and big marketing campaigns. But do you think that that is the way to go in a mass marketing talking about communicating to this market?
Yeah, I think there's a big danger that because, you know, the word mass sort of implies that it's a one-size-fits-all approach. And I think the textbooks are being rewritten on a daily basis, that the traditional mass marketing approach, where you just beat the same consumers over the head with a single-minded message the whole time, just isn't the way to go. I mean, any market, any society is made up of a whole group of different communities. And I think obviously the buzzword in marketing around the world is kind of social networks and social communities. And these mass markets, or at least they're now being called main markets, not emerging markets, these are markets that are made up of a whole bunch of different sub-communities, whether those communities are geographic or interests or passion points or whatever. And I think the smart marketers have got to understand that it isn't one size fits all, and you've got to find what unites those communities as their interests and their needs, and engage with them in smaller communities.
So are you saying that traditionally, you know, mass markets were seen as homogeneous markets, and that we have to move away from that and actually segment the markets into different target markets?
Absolutely. Look, I think obviously in terms of the rest of the marketing mix, you know, your distribution footprint, I think Terry mentioned a company like Coca-Cola, you know, you've got to have those economies of scale. But at the same time, even a brand like Coca-Cola understands that the way you engage with different consumer segments is driven by their own, the way they gather together, whether it be in lifestyle, you know, as I say, geographic, etc. So you've really got to be careful that you don't just have a one-size-fits-all approach.
Right. Do you agree with that, Gigi?
Yeah, I would. And I think one of the big mistakes that people make is that one sees people in Western trappings and assumes people have westernized. And the reality is that people are modernizing as opposed to westernizing. And so they take their cultures and many of their traditions with them. So for instance, we see someone in Sandton having a lobola still, or a sacrifice ceremony. So we mustn't make the mistake of seeing people in Western clothes and assuming that they don't have their own social networks, cultural practices, and those kind of elements that we need to micro-market to and understand them in terms of our marketing campaign.
Don't you find that consumers within this market are very loyal, very brand loyal? You know, it's almost like brands are entrenched from an early age, and that could maybe be from a cultural point of view.
I think so, except I think that the reality is that as we move from an apartheid era in South Africa particularly, you're finding that we are now part of a society which is about choice. And it's about me, and it's about I can choose whatever I want. So loyalty is being questioned against whether I'm getting something from this brand, or how is it benefiting me, or is this my choice, or am I blindly following what my parents did before me?
Because brands can't dictate anymore, is it? I mean, consumers are getting more and more demanding, as you say, and this obviously we're seeing this in the same market. What is your findings, Terry?
I think Gigi's point around following the brands that our parents used to follow is a valid one. But if you look at the market, I mean, the age of the market is changing rapidly. In Brazil, over 40s are an elderly niche. In the Arab countries, 50% of the population is under 28. In Africa, it's about the youth, pure and simple. I mean, the vast majority of the continent's population and South Africa's population are a very, very youthful population. And the brands that they follow and the brands that they aspire to need to get in sync with that and get in sync with that quite quickly. Because you find a lot of the brands that we consume in these markets are almost forced upon us by Western brand houses. I mean, right. For example, if you look at the cosmetic brands, they are largely there to service European women who demographically are aging. I mean, the average age of a African female is under the age of 20. Their only concern is, how do I get a date on Friday night? They're not into anti-aging creams. Right. So you find that the mismatch between what's available and what the consumers in these emerging mass markets want, is there's a bit of a gap there.
Ian, would you agree with what Terry is saying?
Absolutely. Look, I think we've recognized in the very early days the importance of the youth market. And I think particularly they are, like youth around the world, they are dreamers and they have big hopes and ambitions. And whilst they might be in poor backgrounds or coming from poor areas, they have far bigger dreams than the rich young kids in the suburban areas. So the danger is to sort of to patronize them and limit those ambitions. So it's really understanding what drives them, that they are a very astute bunch of people now. They might not have formal education, but they've got very high levels of street, the university of life, mm-hmm. and armed with a mobile phone, there's nothing that they can't find out or nothing that they can't do. So we kind of underestimate them at our peril. Mm.
Do you think we'll see the rise of social media within these markets? We know that digital, or mobile rather, has 100% penetration, where digital we're still getting there with broadband issues. But do you think it's a trend that we'll see, sort of social media trends?
Look, I think social media trends will occur through mobile. I think it's many years before we jump through to digital computers, whatever it might be. However, within that, mobile is hugely powerful. I mean, if you look at Mozambique recently, there were riots in Mozambique that were primarily driven by SMS, to the extent that the government actually closed down the SMS networks for 2 weeks to control it. Now, that was purely interaction on a social network, which is maybe an informal one. It's not a Mixit or it's not right. a Facebook or something, but there are these very strong social networks. And I think they're informal social networks, so we often struggle to actually contain it or understand it or put a tag on it, in a sense.
But yet the just shows you the power of communication, whether it's just an SMS, doesn't have to be Facebook. It's certainly happening. So who's getting it right, would you say? What brands come to mind?
It really depends on the segment. I think if you look at how brands have evolved over the last 10 or 20 years, the ones that used to get it right in the past, the big brands like LG and Sony and Samsung, that came from markets that typically, like 30 years ago, Sony was not considered to be a premium brand. It was considered to be a brand that was sort of low cost, very similar to the Chinese brands we see today. Today it's considered to be a premium brand.
Yeah.
If you look at, it took them 40 years. If you look at LG, if you look at Korean brands like Samsung, it took them 15 years. We have new entrants into the market now that are turning themselves into global premium brands within a 5 or 6 year period. I think a great example of a mass market brand in Africa very recently is Airtel. Airtel has 110 million customers alone in India. Yeah. It took over Zain in November of last year.
That's it.
And it has rolled out into 16 countries within a 6 month period. And now it's the buzzword all over Africa.
But why do you think makes them so successful launching the brand within Africa?
I think they understand the market. I think there's a big gap between traditional Western brands' understanding of what the consumer in these markets want and also what they're allowed to provide. I mean, the great example I use is the fridge. If you take your standard fridge, you go and buy it in a consumer electronics store, you put it into a mass market home in Africa, we have huge electricity problems. There are power surges, there's a lack of electricity. That item is not going to last particularly long.
Yeah.
I came across a very interesting company in India who developed a fridge for the mass market. Weighs 7.6 kilograms, can run without electricity, costs $63. that's what people want.
Yeah.
So where you have people in emerging markets, or as they say, products developed by sort of poorer markets for other poorer markets, they hit the nail on the head very quickly.
Ian, any comments on that?
Yeah, I think Terry touches on the right point that we mustn't assume, and I think Gigi mentioned it as well, we sometimes think that African youth are aspiring to just be Western and blindly adopting anything the West throws at them. Whereas I think particularly, maybe more in South Africa than some other African countries, it's really about adapting those things. And we were involved with a really interesting project with Levi Strauss, where they were wondering why black girls weren't buying their jeans. And it's because they didn't quite understand that black girls, South African black girls, are very proud of their curves. They don't want to be the skinny white girls that they see in all the international advertising. And so Levi's were sort of smart enough to say, right, well, let's actually develop a pair of jeans specifically for young African females. And so it came from a very powerful insight about how to adapt a global brand to local needs, rather than just assuming that consumers would take what an international brand would give them.
And on Ian's point, Gigi, how do you go about getting those, you know, those little gems, those consumer insights in terms of, let's look at the Levi's ad for, or production for, as an example, to actually know that these are little cultural things that we need to change as a brand if we want to target that specific market?
I think one of the first mistakes people make is they confuse consumer insights and understanding with consumer behavior. And the reality is what people do is very different to the kind of passion points, things like hopes, dreams, aspirations. Those kind of things are what makes us behave in a certain way. We make the mistake of seeing how people behave and then we assume we can build a brand into that behavior, as opposed to understanding those kind of deeper insights, those passion points. And our belief is very much that one has to get into the shoes of the consumer to understand those things better. Completely away from South Africa, a company overseas that was dealing with the old age market developed a suit for their staff where they put them in, they saw blurred, they could move with very stiff movements, and they put them into supermarkets and said, go and find our product, and they couldn't read the labels and they couldn't reach it high on a shelf. So those are the kind of things like simulation exercises that allow you to really get into your consumer's shoes and understand who are the trendsetters, understand why people change, the deeper components.
We're going to have to leave it here. Thank you so much. We're going to a quick break. Well, don't go away, because when we come back, more on communicating effectively to the mass market. See you in a bit.